So, touchdown here in Egypt. I'm in Cairo right now at the Marriott, joined with a tour group who I am going to spend the next week and a half exploring Egypt slash the pyramids slash all the ancient sites. But what's different is, as I said, this is a Khemitology tour, so it's not official sanctioned, like, British people history that they threw on the Egyptians. This is the Bedouin native Egyptian understanding and history of the pyramids. So that's where I'm at right now, and we're about to do that, but I'm checking out my spot right now, and I noticed some really cool things happening outside, so come check this out. Looks like a wedding.
These are all some of the vessels that was found in the corridors underneath the step pyramid. But they are known even to the mainstream archaeologists that they existed before the time of Djoser. Djoser is the king from the third dynasty, supposedly the owner of the step pyramid. Supposedly the oldest structure from stone. And of course, dating and relating and understanding the function of every site depends on translating the hieroglyphs that exist in the site, the oldest, of course. So in some few of these stone vessels, they found these inscriptions from the Archaic Age. The Archaic Age is the first and the second dynasties. Around 2800 BC, if we follow the British timeline, and around 5600 BC, if we follow the Egyptian priest Manetho's timeline. Anyways.
And that was not used after that script?
Be patient.
Yeah.
It was used after that, of course, because we display it here to make money out of it. It could be, but okay. The names here, we can see how crude it is added, and it is not reflecting the same capability of the machining itself. Look at this first piece. First of all, we have here, this is, they call it schist, but this is not schist. This is known as silt stone, is the closest to it, according to geologists. It's a type of quartzite with a very intense structure. So it's a solid 7 on the Mohs scale. For the solidness of stones, when we know diamond is at 10, this is at 7. Can you see the striations?
Yeah, in the bowl in the middle. Yeah.
In the middle, take a closer look.
Yeah.
What is that?
It implies it's made by a machine.
Oh, yeah.
Very fine machine.
Yeah.
So any normal lathe would not be able to carve in a 7 on the Mohs scale unless you have another diamond rotating tip at the same time. So it's not that you're gonna bring a carbide blade and go and cut through that stone, no. It had to be another rotating tip on the other side. I produced some of those from calcite, and these shapes are so complicated and sophisticated, even in calcite. So where is the handles is another challenge, actually. And the drilling the handles is even more challenging. But this is not the case. Let's read here what is the explanation. Because we want to talk. Now we look at, if you know the different types of stones, we said silk stone, we have Persia, we have porphyry, we have marble, we have diorite gneiss, we have granodiorite, We have rose granite and we have tonalite. Tonalite is the same material people used it as founders to recycle the granite stone in the structures. So this stone is actually harder than rose granite. So they are all in seven, but seven still had differences because the amount of quartz that is in the stone. So granite stone, if it's less than 20% quartz, it's labeled as cyanite. If it's more, then it's granite. But they are all granite. But like, if it's lower than 20, then we call it cyanite. Tonalite is high percentage of quartz in it, like 70%. So it is really solid. This is
an
unidentified
coin. Exactly. Some black ops like kind of thing.
Wow. You look with your two eyes.
Really.
Okay. Here is a plan for some of the corridors underneath the step pyramid. And these two corridors is where they found these stone vessels stashed. Okay, now they will tell you here, and this is important because you gotta read between the lines what is happening here. The production of the stone vessels before Imhotep. So these were all produced from, believe it or not, if you follow and study those as I did, you will find that they found them in some of the prehistory barriers. Prehistory. And I'm talking like according to the data that is displayed in the Nubian Museum, cannot get more official than that, that they found it in sites that when they carbon dated these sites, the site was between 12,500 and 14,000 years ago. So here they say, of course, they explain like the art, as art, but it's not more to art than in industry. And luxury, whatever. Did they have luxury something? Did they have a phrase that says luxury 12,000 years ago? But this is our explanation. Anyway, hold mainly cosmetic materials and oil. No, it's alchemy materials.
Mm, that's is a, yeah, hell yeah.
Yes. Here, listen to this. Reached its peak during the first two dynasties, which is, as I told you, the Archaic Age. Why did they get to this conclusion? Because they found these graffiti carved on him. And I will show you more examples in the Egyptian Museum. The important, the other important part, all of the types of stone found in Egypt were used. And this is true, but then some. Like we will see some in the Egyptian Museum from milky quartz, from red jasper, from yellow jasper, from rock crystal quartz, from amethyst, and so on. This is called, this is a metamorphic stone called the diorite gneiss, and this is not from Egypt. It's actually coming from Sudan. Two mountains, one is called the Borkul and one is called Arusa. So let me, like my question for, as an industry, not as art, what is the first thing that you need to bring the material? All the types of stones, what does that require? It requires that I will send groups to search for the stone. And the granite is in Aswan, while granite urite and the marble and porphyry and Persia is in the eastern desert. These are hundreds of kilometers far from each other. Plus, as you can see, the quality of the stone is not something that you find on the surface. It's something that is coming from the core. We still didn't talk about machining. We're just talking about bringing the stone. So my question, who established a quarry system to own the types of stones 12,000 years ago? Plus, if you look at these barriers that they found this in them, they were the most primitive barriers. So it will be actually more that they also inherited those from somebody, from whom? Supposedly before that, there is no history. And that's why this subject is very important, because these were found in very, very primitive barriers and Neolithic villages.
And the barriers were 12,000 years old. So the
barriers, we will see other examples of these stone vessels, the same ones, displayed in the Egyptian Museum. And they are in display side by side with pottery that was shaped by hand. That means before the dynastic Egyptians or the pre-dynastic in the Neolithic era invents the pottery wheel. So it's random shapes. Side by side, look at those. This every circle in the middle is a result of a tubular drill. And in the Flinders Petrie Museum in England, he has many of calcite and rock crystal and other materials. And the core of a tubular drill in the stone itself still exists inside the vessel. So there is no doubt. Where do we find this machining? With the pyramid builders. And we will see plenty of it, of course, in Abu Sir tomorrow, I will show you. So the tubular drill and the saw cutting is the two tools or tool marks that we found as a result on the surfaces of the stones, but we never found them displayed on the walls by the dynastic Egyptians or found as tool, as the tool itself, from copper, from anything, nothing. And now we know how old these went and side by side was what. So the main question, who established the quarry system back in these days to all the types of stones? And then we will talk about machines. These are reflecting the ancient advanced lost technology or the modern machining as Flinders Petrie called it in the 1880s. While on the other side, let's now look on the other side. Radiocarbon dating for organic series that they found in the prehistory
You can see the striations on it.
Totally. It's like how it's so obvious that it wasn't it had some sort of machine involved.
But the thing is what kind of drill allows you to go from here to this?
Like narrow and narrow.
Right?
Yeah.
It's
this scene and other
psychic powers.
Was carved on the
drama.
This bee also in
hieroglyphs.
And the seal is this one, and this is a cylinder seal. We will see some of them displayed in the Egyptian Museum.
Lord of the South.
The ruler of the South. حقاش معون
غريتب اللي هو الكاهن المرتكب.
He was also a chanting priest.
الربع الأمير الوراثي.
He was also a royal prince.
ورمأة اللي هو كبير الناظرين.
Yeah, he مأة here means the one who views, and this can be an astronomical title or an esoterical title. So he see
like illumination.
Yeah, exactly.
بعد كده إيمحتب. إيمحتب his name.
إيمحتب and then the name.
وده اسم الملك زوسر.
This,
غيتري.
That shape with the falcon on top of it is known as Serich. And this is usually where the name of the king will be located. So the name Zosar is actually what was found in the king's lists in the Middle Kingdom. But the old kingdom used to write him differently, which is Netrighet. Means Ghet is a ideogram that you see here, is the back of an animal with the tail and the nipples. It means the body. And Netr means nature or divine.
This is very interesting. So we got the cobra facade, king's tombs, and these like cobras up top, and I'm guessing it was. Look at the cobras. I am going to ask Yousef what the real definition or what, you know, symbolic representation the cobras were used for. Protection.
In that.
Just in that one.
Just
but,
in that one.
Okay.
In the Valley of the Kings, when you see the gates, they represent the gates. And they also represent transactions, like You can find snakes with bird head.
Yeah.
And combination snakes with wings and snake with lion's head and things like that.
Yeah.
But also, even the normal snake, they have different names for different functions. Lots of it is in astronomy.
Oh, okay.
And astronomy and the underworld somehow got connected in the ancient world.
As above, so below.
As above,
so below. I see some similarity because, like, pharaohs will have, like, cobras on their forehead, and it reminds me of, like, ancient Vedic culture where it's all about your kundalini energy, raising, like,
yes,
snake energy up to your forehead.
Yeah.
And pharaohs often had a cobra coming out of their forehead, so that implies, yeah, some level of higher consciousness.
Also, the cobra and the vulture.
Yeah.
Same like South America, the condor and the snake.
Yeah.
We have here the older one, of course, is the cobra and the vulture, and it's a symbol of unification, two females, Nipti. But any new unification, it will be represented as the unification of Upper and Lower Egypt. But maybe it's more than
that. Okay, cool, thank you.